Hi there. So, first of all, I'd like to thank you all for the very kind and positive response I got from on the last couple of videos I made. So I thought I'd make another educational video about what actually happens to your body when you're corseting. Now, I am not a doctor, so don't take anything in this video as absolute fact, but I had done my research very, very carefully, and I did do my undergrad in biochemistry and had taken some physiology courses at the university level, so I do have a fair bit of knowledge. What actually inspired me to do this video is, you know, when I'm going around in public with my corset on, I have people come up and stop me and say, "Oh my gosh, where did your waist go? Where did your organs go? What happened to your ribcage?" So I hope this will clarify a few things for you. So the two things I'll be talking about in this video are what happens to your organs when you're corset training, and also what happens to your bones. Now, in terms of organs, when you're pregnant, for example, if you're a woman — there are men who corset, but if you're a woman and you're pregnant, then there is a lot of squishing and compression going on when you're pregnant and when your baby is growing larger and larger. So your bladder moves down. I know a lot of you women know about that. Your stomach and your pancreas and your liver move up. That's why you get a lot of heartburn in your last trimester. Your organs get pushed back. Sometimes you can have renal problems and spleen problems when you're in your very last month of pregnancy. So moving around your organs is nothing new. Your organs are not cemented in one specific place. They can move around. So when you're corseting, you're not going to put your corset on for the very first time and restrict yourself 10 inches. That's just crazy talk. What you're actually going to do is initially restrict yourself maybe just 1 or 2 inches. And then as the months go by, or the years go by even, then you would slowly move your waistline down to the point where you want it. So corsetry is not about injuring yourself by pulling yourself as tight as you possibly can. And, you know, it's the same way with pregnancy. Both take a lot of time so that the body has the time and the space to react and adapt to the changes you're putting on it. An example of your organs changing position in a more sudden way, you know, not so gradual, would be the practice of nolli. It's a yoga move in which you actually use the strength of your own abdominal muscles to pull all of your digestive organs up into your rib cage, and you kind of move them around and massage them. So that isn't dangerous at all. In fact, a lot of the yoga masters believe that this is good for the digestive system, and this massages all your organs. It's completely safe. So definitely your organs can move around, and it is not unnatural for them to move around. So the organs that are mostly moved when you're corseting are the ones that are in the front of your gut. So those are the organs that are said to be in the peritoneal cavity. So this includes the stomach, the liver, the spleen, and a lot of the large and small intestines. Now, the organs that are in the back of your torso, such as the renal system, being your kidneys, the adrenal system, the adrenal glands, your pancreas, and also the organs that are in the pericardial cavity, so a lot of your main blood vessels in your heart, those are not as affected by your corseting. They're not going to be very compressed. If you do have a corset that compresses a lot of these other organs, then either your corset is super duper tight, or you are not wearing a proper corset. So one of the advantages of having mostly your peritoneal organs compressed is the fact that your stomach and your large and small intestines are mostly hollow organs. They're mostly membranes with a large surface area. So just the same way that they can expand to large volumes because you can fill them with food or whatever, in the same way you can compress them flat. And you can definitely compress them to very small volumes if you've ever looked at the nolli videos on YouTube. So in terms of your spleen, it's actually part of your lymphatic system. What it is, it acts similar to your tonsils, in which It sweeps out a lot of the waste in your body and it empties it into your large intestine to be expelled later on. It also holds a lot of antibodies, so when you get sick, it releases these antibodies so it can actually kill the foreign objects. Now, if you have a damaged spleen, like a lot of people who have mono, like the kissing disease, they can sometimes have a damaged spleen. Some people actually have their spleens removed. You can live without your spleen, but there are risks of, having more infections and being more susceptible to sickness when you're introduced to new bacteria and viruses. Now, in terms of the liver, it is essential for life. But one of the awesome things about the liver is that it can actually regenerate itself. So that means it can heal itself and it can restore itself to its original size if you only have half a liver, for instance, because of an organ transplant. It can also grow multiple lobes. So when you hear stories about women in the past having corset liver, what that means is the liver actually has lobes that are stacked up more vertically as opposed to the more traditional arrangement of the lobes growing out sideways like a normal liver does. But in my research, I never found any situations that proved that the corset livers actually function any differently or worse than any normal liver. Now, when you breathe, what happens is you have a diaphragm that is stretched across, like a cross section through your body. And when you take a breath in, that diaphragm moves down like this. So what that does is it creates a vacuum inside your body. It causes your lungs to expand, and there is a lower air pressure inside your body than outside of the body. So a lot of the air rushes in. When you're corseting, then the lower part of the lungs can't expand quite as much, and the diaphragm can't pull down quite as much, but it is not hugely adversely affected. Obviously, I do not wear my corset when I'm exercising, when I'm extremely stressed out, when I'm singing or playing the flute, I don't wear my corset because those activities require a lot of heavy breathing. But for normal day-to-day breathing, it works perfectly fine for me. Additionally, there have been some studies done on a lot of adults who have been corseting for years and years, most of their lives, and there is some evidence of adaptation of their bodies in which their upper lungs increase in their lung capacity to compensate for the loss of lung capacity in their lower lungs. So the body can adapt in all sorts of ways.